morning. That was very bright and cheery. Morning. It is lovely to see you. My name is Tara. If I don't know you, I'm a member of the staff team here at St. Mungo's. And I want to say to you this morning that you are really welcome here. Now, you might hear that, and maybe some of you might think, I think, Tara, if you knew my week, you might not say that. Maybe if you knew what I did last night, you might not say that. If you knew how I spoke to my loved one this morning, or what I thought about my neighbor as I drove out of the driveway this morning, you might not say that. But you know, I was up early this morning, I went on a little walk, and I saw the sunrise, and I was reminded of these words from Lamentations 3. Yet this I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And you know, in a moment, we are going to sing some words about God. We're going to be able to say at the start of a new day, you are rich in love and slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. And so I want to say to you again this morning, you are welcome. Not just from me, but actually you are welcomed here by the God of the universe, who loves you and knows you and wants to meet with you this morning, who wants you to meet him and encounter him this morning. That is good news. Yeah? Okay. If we are able, let's stand together and let's sing our opening worship.
Swift and sailing, the end draws near, and my time.
Amen. So let me just repeat my welcome for those of you who just have come in. It's lovely to see you here this morning, particularly if you are visiting with us. And if you are, then we have refreshments at the end of the concourse at the end of the service. And we have a welcome point where we'd love to meet you if you're here for the first time. We have a connect point if you are just looking to meet some maybe new faces that you haven't said hello to yet at St. Mungo's, then do pop over there. And we also, as ever, have a place for healing prayer. If you would like some healing this morning, then you are welcome to go there after the service, and there'll be some people there who would love to pray with you. Couple of other notices. So this evening, we have our evening service at 6:30 in Ladycroft, and Isaac is going to be sharing with us on the topic of love. And of course, there will be worship, there will be prayer ministry. So please do come along if you are able. So that's in the church building at 6:30. Our next baptism service is going to be the morning, well, the lunchtime of Sunday, the 3rd of November. So make a little note of that date for your calendar to come along. But we would love to baptize some more people. And so if that's something that you've been thinking about, if you've been thinking, do you know what, I haven't been baptized, I'm wondering maybe this might be the time, this might be the moment. It's still not too late for the 3rd of November. And if you don't get this one, then the next one's not going to be till the spring. So if that is something that is of interest to you, if you think, yeah, maybe this is my time, do send an email to the inquiries at St. Mungo's email address if you would like to let us know about that. And then the other thing to let you know about is we have finally been able to pin down the date for the Christmas carol service. Woohoo! I know, some of you are like, oh no, they're talking about it. But yes, we are. We're very excited. Saturday, the 21st of December, it will be in here in the concourse. So do start thinking and praying about who you might be able to invite along. It's a great opportunity to invite people who maybe wouldn't usually come to church, but they really would love to come to a carol service. And so this is a great chance for us to bring people along. So it'd be fantastic to see the concourse absolutely packed full on that date. So pop that one in your diary. And I'm going to hand over to Ollie for the final notice.
Thanks, Tara. Now, one of the things that I really appreciated when I first became a follower of Jesus, a disciple, was that the guys who discipled me, and I was able to see what it looked like to follow Jesus and also to learn, to ask all the questions I had. Why do you do this? Why do you do that? And it was amazing. They helped me very quickly to become a disciple of Jesus. And one of the ultimate priorities for us, well, the ultimate priority for us in life is to follow Jesus. Amen. If you're a Christian, that's what you're defined by. You're defined that you're a child of God and that you're a disciple of Jesus. And you are to do what Jesus says. Come follow me and I will send you out to fish for people. And as we follow Jesus, spending time with him, we'll become more like him and we'll start to do the things that he did. And part of that is to go and fish for people so they might follow Jesus too. And the carol service is an amazing opportunity to go fishing for people. Invite them to somewhere where they're going to hear the good news, they're going to encounter God, or Spirit Cafe. In our culture, there are so many competing voices trying to conform us to their thinking so that we actually don't just think, but start to do what they're calling us to do. And Paul, in his letter to the Christians in Rome, remember what Rome was like. It was a barbaric place. Rome wasn't a nice place to be a Christian. It was a horrific place to be a Christian. And in the midst of that culture, Paul says this, do not conform to the pattern of this world. That's the thinking of what you're seeing around you, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And being conformed to the thinking of the world is happening in our lives, whether we like it or not, unless we choose to be transformed by the renewing of our mind, by putting into practice the teaching of Jesus. Remember, we talked about putting on the yoke. That's the teaching of Jesus, so that we become more like him in our daily lives. Now, the Practicing the Way course was designed to help each of us, as a church, to encourage us to be transformed as we practice the way of Jesus and become like him. And this is why we're using the course in our house groups, so that we can learn together as we put the practices of Jesus into place and the teaching of Jesus into place. We can then practice them on our own as spiritual experiences. And I know some of you are already putting those into practice. We can reflect on these as we encounter God, and then we can process these together so we can support and encourage each other as we continue to be discipled and be disciples. And in any course, you only get out what you put in. So I really want to encourage you to take the time to attend house group. If you're in a house group, please attend house group and put into practices those that the course is suggesting. And for those of you who are not in a house group, I'd really encourage you to go on the Practicing the Way website and log in and register and start following the course for yourself. So as we spend time with Jesus and put into practice his teachings in our daily life, we'll be transformed and become more like Jesus and have a greater desire to live for him, to see others come to know Jesus. We'll go fishing and we'll see other people come to know them. To know Jesus. So my prayer through this whole course is that we become a church which is passionate to live for Jesus as his disciples and have a heart to see others come to know the Messiah who we follow. Amen? Bless you. I'm going to ask Tara to come back up.
Okay, we're now going to move on with our worship into our morning liturgy, and the prayers will come up on the screen and you say the words that are in bold and italic. O Lord, open our lips and our mouths shall proclaim your praise. Give us the joy of your saving help. We have come together in the name of Christ to offer our praise and thanksgiving, to hear and receive God's holy word, and to seek forgiveness of our sins, that by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may give ourselves to the service of God. Jesus says, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is close at hand." So let us turn away from our sin and turn to Christ, confessing our sins in penitence and faith. And so we pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We're going to pause for a moment and remember the situation in the Middle East, and particularly Gaza. And we'll have a moment of silence and an opportunity for each of us to pray ourselves quietly before the Lord. Amen. If you're able, please do stand. Blessed is the Lord, for he has heard the voice of our prayer. Therefore shall our hearts dance for joy, and in our song we will praise God. We say together, O be joyful in the Lord, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness, and come before his presence with a song. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. For the Lord is gracious, his steadfast love is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever.
Free. Praise to the Lamb who was slain for us.
Yeah, Father, we thank you for your presence. I was driving over Harlow this morning to 8:45, and I think I'm one of the most blessed pastors because I just see the Pentlands in all their glory. And this morning, as I looked toward the hills, as I lifted my eyes towards the hill, it's just you could see the sun starting to hit just the top of the hills, and I was just reminded of the glory of the Lord. And Psalm 129, I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. And he goes on to say that he will not let your foot slip. He goes on to tell you how he cares for us. And Andrea had a word, which I think is just really in line with this. He is our helper. It says in the New Testament, it says that we can approach God's throne of grace with confidence to find mercy and grace in time of need. And maybe there are some situations where you're just stuck. Maybe it's a family situation. Maybe it's a job situation. And you just feel stuck. Well, God is our helper in times of trouble, and we can approach him with boldness and confidence. And one of his names that Andrea actually brought up was that he is the God of the breakthrough. Amen? As you read scriptures, you see, not just in the Old Testament, the New Testament, that actually there were situations where if God hadn't moved, nothing would have happened. You know, the early church had just been stuck. But that as they worshiped, as they gave over the situation to the God of the breakthrough, in their prayers and crying out to him, he brought the breakthrough. And I just wonder, as we worship, is an incredibly powerful gift that God has given us to bring the breakthrough. And so why don't we just continue to worship? And I want us just to push into all hail the Lamb who was slain for us. There's something anointed on that bridge. And so I want us just to keep singing that and just imagine the Lamb who's been worshipped in heaven right now, that he's got the breakthrough. That he just needs to speak and the situation will be changed. He just needs to speak and you will be given the grace and the power to walk through this. So as we just sing this, I want you to start just crying out to God. If you've got a situation where you've been just stuck, start crying out to the God of the breakthrough. If there's a friend you've just been praying for ages to receive the gospel and they haven't received, just start crying out for them. Or if there's just a situation in your family especially and you just need breakthrough, just cry out to God. Remember what Tara said. He welcomes you this morning. He's a good, good Father. So let's just sing this and worship the Lord and let's use this as just breakthrough. But let's be crying out to God. And when I mean crying out to God, let's not be quiet. Amen? We're in the church family. If we can't do it here, where can we do it? But let's cry out this morning, believing that God is our helper and he's the God of the breakthrough. Let's just push in. Let's allow God to be God this morning. Thank you. Let's just align ourselves to that word that Fiona's just spoken. There is nothing that he cannot do, amen. I feel there's a bit of tension in the room where some people are saying, I'm going to still look for other things, other ways to right this problem. Well, actually, just give up. Just come to the God of the breakthrough. Come to the Lord who can do all things. Just put your faith. We're going to be hearing a story about a man who brought his son to Jesus this morning, and he says, if you, and Jesus says, all things are possible for those who believe. So let's just believe this morning, put our trust and our faith in him, not in ourselves, but in him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And let's just behold him. I believe his glory's here. So let's just behold him, because remember what Paul said, as we behold the Lord of glory, we are transformed. Let's just behold him. Thank you, Lord. Keep coming, Lord of glory. We long to behold more of you and your glory in this place. Thank you, Lord. Align our hearts and minds to you this morning. Thank you, Lord God. We behold you in your glory. God of glory, we behold you this morning. Just be listening for what the Lord might say to you as you behold him this morning. I just see a lady with her head down. And the Lord says to you, the Father says to you, you are special in my sight, for you're fearfully and wonderfully made. You're unique. Raise up your head, for you are my daughter. I see a guy just looking at his feet, just shuffling uneasily, kind of thinking about maybe what he's been up to this week. And the Father calls you to him. You might need to confess what you've been up to, but he calls you to him. You're the only one stopping you coming to the Father this morning. He loves you. He demonstrated that by sending his son, Christ, to die on the cross. He's paid the price. He simply wants you to come. Keep coming, Holy Spirit. Let your glory fall on us today. Let your peace fall on us today. Often as we behold the Lord, things start to come up in us, and I feel that there might be someone who's just angry here this morning. They're just feeling that anger starting to rise up as we behold the Lord. And the Lord's just asking you, why are you angry? Do you need to forgive someone this morning? Remember, anger's a secondary emotion. Do you need to forgive as the Lord has forgiven you this morning? Just to give that person to the Lord, let go, to allow that anger to be gone and for the peace of God to come. I also just feel that someone here who says, I despise myself. Well, the Lord doesn't despise you, and you need to hear that this morning. He cherishes you. And you need to come into alignment with how the Lord sees you and thinks about you this morning. And you need to start declaring that. I'm not despised, but I'm loved. I'm not despised, but I'm loved. And you need to stop thinking those thoughts, because they're not from God. They're from the Father of lies. He wants you to stop you from walking into all the love and the promises and the plans that God has for you, to raise up your head. I think this is just a message for us all. Raise up your heads this morning. Fix your eyes on the God of glory, on the King who's coming, and allow him to transform you as you behold him. Come, King of glory, we make way for you today in our hearts and our minds. Make way. Make way for him, the King of glory, the one who is mighty in battle, the King of glory. Why don't we just quietly, whether it's through singing or just speaking, let's just thank him. Thank him for who he is, for who we are in his eyes, that he will do what he's promised to do and that we can do what he's promised. Why don't we just start raising up just a song of love to him, a song of adoration, of worship, whether in words, whether in song. How we love you. Oh, we love you, King of glory. Let it flow from your heart this morning. How we love you, Jesus. Adore you, Jesus, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We adore you. Yeah, we adore you, oh God. We adore you, Adabarishimah. you, Jesus. Thank you for being with us this morning. And just for those who are still struggling, this is the scripture that changed my life. When I was really struggling with believing that God loved me, even though I'd experienced his love, Paul says to the church, he says, he who began a good work in you will continue on until the day of Christ Jesus. That he has not given up on you. He will not give up on you. And as you continue just to walk with him, he will change you and transform you, however difficult the situation is in your life. Amen? And that's what we've got to remember. He's not a God who needs us to be all right. He's a God who loves us and chose us and calls us by name. Even in our darkest moments, he calls you by name. Let's stand on the promises of God. Let's stand on the truth of God. That God so loved the world that he gave his one only son. That whoever believes in him shall not perish, but gain eternal life now. To have a relationship with him now. Remember, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. That Jesus has opened the way up to the Father. That we'd experience that same love that Jesus experienced from the Father. Just look to him this morning. Just align your thinking to him and say, I am loved. I am loved by the Father. Receive his love this morning. Thank you, Father. Let's just, I know sometimes we find this a little bit difficult, but why don't we look at someone we know and just say, you are loved by the Father this morning. You are loved by Abba 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 this morning. Well, it's so exciting to be in God's presence, amen? Just allow him to do what he wants to do, to give him that space. And I just want to honor our young people who are up here this morning. Let's just, thank you. I also want to honor all the leaders and helpers for the Thursday youth worship. We're just so grateful for you. We're so grateful for all our 0-18 volunteers who just sow seeds and release gifts, and that's what we want to see as a church, amen. So if one of these young people blessed you, and you'll see them right across, you'll have seen them. We had some welcomers from the youth. We see them right across the church this morning. We had some at 8:45. If you see them and they blessed you, can you thank them? Amen. We really need you, young people, in this church to be who God's called you to be. Amen. We really need you. Well, this is, some of you might roll your eyes. This is the third week, but not the last week, where we're looking at the spiritual discipline of fasting. And this morning, I'm going to be sharing with you how fasting can amplify our prayers. How fasting can amplify our prayers. Now, I'm talking here in Balerno, but next week, the church family in Livingston are going to be getting a video of me. So I wondered if we can just say hello to the Livingston congregation. Hello, hello, hello. Be blessed. We love you. And we hope that you are encouraged by this word for you next week. Now, some really helpful points for us to remember just as we look at this topic again of fasting. The first one is that Jesus talked about fasting, but never commanded it, and neither did the apostles, but they all practiced it. So fasting is something that they all practiced. A fast is not a requirement to be a disciple of Jesus, but it's a tool we can use to grow in our relationship with Jesus. And there are some people who cannot and should not practice fasting because of health issues. And in line with this point, I want to make this point again that Dave made and Tara made, that we realize that fasting is something that simply is not possible for some in the church family, particularly those who struggle with mental health issues and eating disorders. And we want to make it very clear that we do not expect or advise you to practice fasting, as this may have a very detrimental effect on your health. We would encourage everyone, however, to pray And where possible, if you can fast in line with the advice that we've given in the church email, please do. Now, there are other things that you can fast from, and I've done this in different points in my life. So some of them I've fasted from social media. So we just go, you know, because how many times are we bombarded throughout the day by WhatsApps, Facebook messages, BBC News? I mean, it just is constant. I mean, I have to turn it off. It's just too much for me. And then I have certain times I look at it. Or about the TV. I mean, I've fasted from TV. I always remember when the guy from the, I stopped my TV license and gave my television away after about 6 months. And about a week later, this guy knocked on my door. He said, "I'm from the TV licensing board, man." He said, "Can I come in and just check you haven't got your TV?" And I was like, "Knock yourself out." And so he came in and he thought he knew, so he'd come straight into my living room. There it was. In those days, that's where you had your TV, in the living room. And he said, "Is something wrong with you, pal? You haven't got a TV?" I said, "Yeah, I'm a Christian. I don't need a TV. I was just..." And he's just, "All right, well, knock yourself out." It's just like, but you know what? Actually, sometimes we don't need these things that the world tells us we do need. And as we make room, as we make way, we encounter God. So this morning, I want to talk about fasting and how it can amplify our prayers. Now, I want to start by telling you a story, so I hope you're all sitting comfortably. So, the first year, when I left university, I went and the Lord opened the door for me to go to America. And the first year I spent in the beautiful Northwest. Now, if you've ever been to the Northwest, it's going to come up on a picture, but it looks beautiful. There it is, Mount Rainier in all its glory, Seattle. It's one of the most beautiful states in the whole of the U.S. Now, I was very blessed. I discipled high school and university students in that year. But in that year, a friend asked me to go across and help him in D.C., at an event. And it was at that event that I met the chaplain of the U.S. Senate, and he asked me to come and work for him. And so I finished off my time in the West Coast. I went back. I had an amazing mission trip to Russia and the Ukraine. And then I came home, and I had to get some stuff sorted out and also my visa. And so I'd sent off my visa application. I already had a visa, but I needed to change it because I had taken some legal advice. Anyway, whilst just about 4 days before I flew, I got this letter back from the American Immigration basically saying, "Your visa application has been denied." Very helpful. That was it. And so I was like, what do I do? I feel the Lord's opened this door. So anyway, me and my praying parents, we prayed, and I thought that I would get on the plane. Now, I don't recommend this as a way of sorting out your visa problems, all right? So, maybe it was a bit reckless, but I got on the plane, and my dad had given me a book about a guy called Peter Marshall, who was an amazing Scottish preacher who'd been actually one of the Senate chaplains in the past. So I read this book, and it was an inspiring book, but I said to the Lord, well, I haven't got a piece about this, so at the end of every chapter, I'm going to pray, and I'll keep fasting. So it was a 10-hour flight. So I prayed and I fasted for 9 hours, just kept on going at it, until on the 9th hour, I felt the Lord say, "You can eat." Now, as someone who loved their food, I was like, straight up in the buzzer, with 1 hour to go, any chance I could get some food, and the lovely assistant got me some food. Now, as I then got off the plane and walked up to the immigration department, that was the point where they still call you aliens in America, U.S. citizens or aliens, there was a little doubt starting to creep up in my mind that I had done the wrong thing. Oh, ye of little faith. Okay? I presented my passport. The guy looked at it, scanned it, and then stamped it. And then said to me, "Do you know, there's another visa that would be even better for you. I'll go and get you the paperwork and just wait there." Now, if you know anything about the U.S. Immigration Department, this is not the way things happen. It was a miracle. Now, some of you might just think, yeah, praise the Lord, that this was just a coincidence. Others might just think this was poor planning on my part, and you'd probably be absolutely right. But I actually think as I pray and prayer and fasted, that it amplified my request to the Lord. And before I actually got off the plane, he had sorted it all out. Now, as we look through the scriptures, prayer and fasting go together. And one example of these is in the Gospels, where Jesus comes down off the mountain after his transfiguration, and he gets into, there's an argument going on with the disciples and someone who's been brought to Jesus. So let's turn, if we have, to our Bibles, to Mark chapter 9, and we'll just read about this, and there's something that we learn about fasting within this. So chapter 9 and verse 16 onwards. "What are you arguing with them about?" Jesus asked. A man in the crowd answered, "Teacher, I brought you my son, who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. Whenever it sees him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not." "You unbelieving generation," Jesus replied, "how long shall I stay with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." So they brought him. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth. Jesus asked the boy's father, "How long has he been like this?" "From childhood," he answered. "It has often thrown him into fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." "If you can," Jesus said, "everything is possible for the one who believes." Immediately the boy's father exclaimed, "I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief." And when Jesus saw that a crowd was running to the scene, he rebuked the impure spirit. "You deaf and mute spirit," he said, "I command you, come out of him and never enter him again." The spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said, "He's dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet, and he stood up. After Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, "Why couldn't we drive him out?" I mean, that's a good question, isn't it? They had gone out. They'd already seen deliverance. They'd seen the spirit being driven out of people and healing. So why couldn't they this time? And Jesus replied, "This kind comes come out only by prayer and fasting." Now, I know that's only in some translations, but it's there. It says not just prayer, but fasting. And fasting seems to have a real effect on this situation. Whether Jesus was fasting at that moment, I don't know. But he fasted regularly. He probably fasted weekly. And it's worth noting in the New Testament that fasting was simply prayer, so focused and intense that a person did not give attention to things like eating. I think what Jesus is wanting us to see as his disciples is that the demon in Mark 9 could only come out by intensive prayer. And Comer writes this, "You can pray without fasting and you can fast without praying, but when you combine the two, it's like a chemical reaction that amplifies the power of prayer." Now, so far, we have looked at, in week one, fasting helps us to offer ourselves to Jesus as we lay aside our needs. In week two, fasting helps us to grow in holiness, and as we lay aside our needs, our desires become more focused on Jesus. And then today, we're going to be looking at how fasting can amplify our prayers. Now remember, prayer is used in Scripture to describe how we communicate with God and connect with God and how he communicates with us. Because remember, God wants to speak to us. Comer suggests that we can divide prayer into two areas, listening to God and speaking to God. He states that fasting is a powerful practice that amplifies both God's voice to us and our voice to God. Put another way, fasting is a way to hear God and to be heard by God. So to hear God and to be heard by God. So let's take each of those one by one, to hear God. Now let's turn to Acts 13. So if you've got your Bibles, let's turn to Acts 13. And this is a key point in the life of the early church. Let's read it, Acts 13, verses 1 to 3, where we see how prayer and fasting can help us to hear God. "Now in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manuel, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.' So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them and sent them off. So he was a key moment in the early church. What did Paul and Barnabas go off to do? Well, they went off to share the good news with who? The Gentiles. This was a key moment in the life of the early church. And what do we see the early church do? Well, they're worshiping and they're fasting. They're praying and they're fasting. Why? To get clear direction from the Lord, to hear the Lord. Now, I remember when I was needing clear direction from the Lord when I finished my training with the Church of Scotland. I was at Wester Hills at the time, and I was offered a place as a minister in a local church, and I didn't know what to do. So I went to my favorite beach, which I think the picture is going to come up. Some of you know it, it's Tinningham Beach, just next to Skull. I fasted and I walked up and down that beach probably for about 3 hours, 4 hours, nothing. And I kept on asking the same question, Lord, if you want me to go to this place, would you show me? Would you give me a piece? Nada. So after about 4 hours, I got a bit despondent. So I went and sat on one of the sand dunes. Oh, you little faith, like this. And in that moment, God spoke to me very clearly. He said, I want you to stay and develop a youth ministry at Holy Trinity. And I said to him, oh, man of great faith, I'm not asking you that question. I'm asking you whether I should go to this place. Back came the answer. I want you to stay in Wester Hills. Oh, you have faith. I'm not asking you that question. Back came the third time. Now, any good biblical scholar, which I'm not, would know that three times in the Lord speak, there's a bit of a moment there. And even though as I looked at the situation, the natural, there wasn't any finances for this job, when I went back to my boss, he said, he was very encouraging. He said, well, if the money's there and you'll have to get it, then you can stay. And then the guy who's now my amazing father-in-law, we, over the next 6 months, the Lord opened the gates of heaven and we raised £110,000. Now, praise the Lord. Now, you see, fasting amplifies our prayers so that we can hear God. Now, Dave spoke a wee bit about last week about the spirit, the health kind of things, what happens when we fast in our bodies. But I'm not really going to get into this too much. But the only thing that I'm going to mention is the obvious one, that fasting increases the blood flow to your brain, causing you to be more alert and aware compared to eating, which causes blood to flow to your digestive system, which is why we get a little tired after a big meal. You know that at Christmas, don't you? When you've had a big meal, you kind of just like, you're not the most attentive to the Lord at that point. It might have to be like an earthquake to wake you up rather than a still more small voice. But actually, we've seen the benefits to our relationship with God when we fast. We hear God a lot easier. It strengthens us spiritually, as we see with Jesus as he was tested in the wilderness. We become more passionate, have a greater desire for Jesus. It changes our desires, and we're heard by God, which I'm going to talk about a wee bit more. In the scriptures, Moses is the first person mentioned to fast while on Mount Sinai. And as we look through the rest of the history of God's people in the church, we see that fasting is part of what it means to be a disciple. I remember the first time I started to fast. All these people were fasting around me, so I thought, well, I better give it a go because they're much holier than me, and I want to be like them because they're like Jesus. Anyway, so I went absolutely cold turkey, and I went the whole day. My goodness, it was torture. I had a headache for most of the day. I was grumpy. I was like, what's this? Like this. Maybe I should have started like just fasting from breakfast. And then the next time, once my body got used to that, I could have then fasted breakfast and then lunch. And then once my body got used to that, I could do the whole day. So just really want to encourage you as you fast, and if you've never fasted before, don't just go, right, I'm going to fast for 2 days. Well, good luck with that. All right? I also just listen to what your body. You will, if it's for the first time, you will get a wee headache, and just make sure you're drinking water. But last Monday, for example, when we were fasting and praying for the building project, actually at about 5:30, I get things called continuous migraines, and they're triggered by me not eating. So at that point, 5:30, I had to eat. because I knew I was leading the prayer meeting. I'd have been absolutely no use to anyone. I'd just been lying on the floor or actually in a darkened room at that point. So just listen to your body. But it takes time. But as you do that, you'll really start to hear God. I find it's, as I've got used to it, it becomes easier and easier. And I love to do it because I hear the voice of God when I do it. As we fast, one of the things that will become apparent is just how much time that we spend, like thinking about food, shopping, cooking, and that one we all love, which is washing up. But as Priscilla Shearer said of the practice of fasting, she said this: I'm able to gain perspective on how unbalanced is the amount of time, energy, and effort that I put into my body and into my spirit. When we choose to sacrifice the need of a body to place more importance on the need of the spirit, God himself sits up and takes notice. The heavens are open to us in a way that might not have otherwise been. And Comer writes about what Priscilla just said. Priscilla offers a key insight here. Not only does fasting put us in an ideal position to listen, but it also puts God into an ideal situation to speak. Not only in our mind is our mind attentive, but our heart is humble and hungry. And if we think about the scriptures, we hear this. And I just want to say that some of you aren't able to fast, and that's that you need to hear that. But I want to say, maybe you can't fast, and maybe you can fast on other things like social media, TV, but you can all pray. Beholding prayer, which I talked about as the last of the four in the sermon series on prayer, is something where we just sit and listen for the Lord. And if you can't fast, I'd really encourage you just to go back. If you didn't listen to that or you need to listen to it again, go back, go on the website, and listen to that. That talk and beholding prayer, because God, you'll hear God speak in those moments as you just take time just to be still, to listen, to focus on the glory of the Lord and to hear him. So fasting helps us to hear God, but it also helps us to be heard by God. Think of God's word to Israel through Jeremiah. He says this: you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart, and I will be found by you, declares the Lord. Now, Jeremiah doesn't actually mention fasting, but he uses the phrase with all your heart. And fasting is one way to seek God with all your heart, to stop the thought. I mean, my goodness, I'm thinking about food most of the morning. I'm thinking about my lunch. I'm thinking about what I'm going to have after lunch as a snack. I'm just being real. You know, and fasting helps me, rather than to say, oh, I'm thinking about that chocolate bar I'm going to have after lunch, God, I'm hungry for more of you. And it just helps me to put my attention on God and actually to share the things on my heart with God and to be heard by God. And I've done this in different ways. If there's something really key, I've actually gone away. I've taken time. I might, that might just be a day, or it might just be a walk. But sometimes I've taken 2 or 3 days just to go on retreat. And during that time, I've fasted in the morning and the afternoon. And one example of that would be when I was seeking the Lord for the new vision for St. Mungo's. If you go to the next slide, this is a picture. If you can go to the next slide, that would be great. This is a picture of the hill I was on the top of when the Lord gave me that vision. And at that point, I was just standing there, beholding him as I was fasting. And I'd done that. I'd been crying out for months to get a new vision. And it was in that moment, as I fasted and prayed, he spoke. And he spoke very clearly. Because I believe as we pray and fast, we're heard by God. Something is happening there. He heard my cries to help, and he answered. I also did this the same when we were starting to push into a possible building project. I'd like to tell you that in that moment, God gave me the blueprints for the church, new church building, but he didn't. But his peace came upon me, and that was enough for me to know we could move ahead. Praying with the psalmist, show me the way I should go, for to you entrust my life. When we fast, whether that's beholding prayer, we can do that also, or, you know, as we just fast from food or fast something else, we're actually crying to God. And I believe we're heard by God because it gets his attention, because we're taking our affections off the things of the world and putting them on God. And it helps us in the big decisions of life, as I've showed you. And I'm sure you've got many times where you fasted and prayed and the Lord's spoken to you. I heard one this morning from the 8:45, a significant moment when a couple had fasted and prayed and the Lord spoke in an incredible way. The discipline of fasting and praying is a part of a larger movement in the spiritual journey from decision-making to discernment. Fasting not only allows us to hear God, but to be heard by God. Prayer and fasting helps us to deny ourselves and look to Jesus. Fasting helps us to open our body and soul to God's Spirit so that we can hear His voice. And fasting, I think, as I look back on my life and hear other stories, helps to be heard by God. God hears our prayers whether we are fasting or not, but there's something about fasting that seems to amplify our prayers before God. Look again at Acts 13, this crucial moment in the life of the church. So after they had fasted and prayed, they placed their hands on them, Paul and Barnabas, and sent them out. They fasted to hear, but also to be heard. Now, if you've ever felt stuck in prayer, fasting often brings the breakthrough. Tony Evans, the pastor, said, fasting helps us to activate God's power. Actually, Derek Prince used to say, if you want to see the power of God in your life, you need to fast. To pray through all that stands between you and God's purposes. We need to remember that this isn't, your fasting isn't a way for, you know, to put pressure on God for Him to do our will. That's not God. God won't do that. God won't, like, He's too good a father to say, oh yeah, you fasted, so I'll give it to you, knowing that it wouldn't be good for us. Actually, God only does His will in our lives because it's good. And sometimes, remember, that's the importance of beholding prayer. Remember Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane? He went in saying, is there any other way? And He beheld the Father. And by the end of it, He said, not my will, but yours be done. See, that's what fasting does. That's what beholding prayer does. It aligns us to the will of the Father. And often we find that our prayers are changed. I hope you've been encouraged this morning to think about the possibility of fasting or beholding prayer, one of the two, if you can't fast. Now, I want to finish with a story to show you the power of prayer and fasting that happened in our nation. So in May 1940, the Nazis had just overrun France. 338,000 Allied troops were in retreat and were trapped on the beach at Dunkirk. And that's a picture of just some of the troops that were trapped there. And it seemed like there was no hope. There was no hope of rescue. And the British Prime Minister, Winston Churchill, was facing the annihilation of the British Army, the last events between England and the Third Reich's Blitzkrieg advance. But on Friday, May the 24th, Hitler issued a baffling order to his generals to stop this assault. The German tank division stopped 10 miles from Denmark. The city was enveloped in a strange mist, and there was a mix of fog and smoke, and the German Luftwaffe could not bomb the soldiers on the beach. Even stranger, the English Channel was perfectly calm for 3 days, and historians write, like bathwater, which made it possible for hundreds of small civilian boats, such as we see on the screen, to cross the channel and rescue the troops under the fog. The story was made famous, yet again, by the 2017 film Dunkirk. And if you haven't seen it, it's a great film. But what's not in that film, and what's often not in the history of that moment, is that also on Friday, May the 24th, King George, upon hearing the news of the impending invasion, called the nation to a day of fasting and prayer. Tens of thousands of people literally lined up to get into Westminster Abbey. You can see this is a picture of it here. And across the nation to plead for God's mercy. And just hours after King George called for prayer, Hitler ordered his tank division to stop. And over the next 3 days, 338,000 troops were saved. The generation there who'd prayed did not call it Dunkirk. They called it the miracle of Dunkirk. Why was it a miracle? Because they had prayed and fasted. We often mistakenly assume that God is going to do what He's going to do with or without our prayers. But the pattern you read through all scripture and history is that when God's people pray, and especially when they fast and pray, He responds. And scripture is full of stories like King Jehoshaphat, Esther, and the church in Antioch. And that's continued. All to say, when it comes to hearing and being heard by God, not only is fasting an aid to prayer, but it's an amplifier to prayer. I wonder if the band can come up. And I'm just going to give you this image. When I was 18, me and my friends all competed to get the best stereo. And I'm not talking about the Amstrad stereos. You know, we spent all our money on, you know, on really good amplifiers. And even then, I remember the amplifier I bought. I'd save money. Yeah, I bought this amplifier, Cambridge amplifier, for £150. It was secondhand. I was just like, this is the business. And then I got a secondhand turntable. I got Mission speakers. You'll know what I'm talking about if you like stereos like this. And, you know, I remember I put... I had thousands of records, and I remember just putting the needle on. And the first thing I put on was Bach's Unaccompanied Cello Suites. I was just waiting to hear this beautiful sound. Bach Unaccompanied Cello Suite number one. And I could see the turntable going round. There was no sound. It's like, what's going on here? It's very odd. I spent all this money. And then I looked, and I realized I hadn't put the amplifier on. And as soon as I clicked on the amplifier, this beautiful music started to rise up. I just want to encourage you. Sometimes God, yes, we pop up a prayer, and he answers it because he's a good, good father. But sometimes we need to dig in, and we need to pray and fast. And it seems to amplify our prayers to the Lord. So I want to finish with three questions. Do you have any stories or clear answers to prayer where you've prayed and fasted and God has answered? And I'd really encourage you, if you do, at coffee time, can you share them with those you're speaking to? Because it builds a faith up. What's an area in your current life where you're praying for discernment or you need to make a decision, seeking to know the will of God for your life and your direction? And in this, do you need to practice fasting? And if you can't fast from food, remember you can fast from other things and you can also behold them in prayer. But is that what you need to do in this moment? Not just complain about it, but actually do something about it in the spiritual. And then the last, what's an area in your current life where you're praying for a breakthrough? If fasting amplifies prayer, why don't we try it? Why don't we give it a go? We read about it in the life of the church. We hear about it in our friends' lives. But if we've never done it, I'd encourage you to do it this morning. You've heard the stories from me, some quite amazing stories. Stories where I was completely like, God, if you don't show up now, I'm not going to be able to do anything here. And he did. We're going to ask the prayer ministry team just to come up quickly. And what I'm just praying, I want, so if the prayer ministry, because we're a bit late, so if prayer ministry team, you can just come up now. And I think just off the back of some of the words this morning, this is an opportunity for us to come up and just get filled with the Spirit again, but also to come up and say, I'm placing my faith in you today, God, in these situations. And this is the first step. Actually, there might be some who have got difficult situations, and you need the breakthrough. And so I'd encourage you, as the first step of faith, just to come up and just say, I need you, and I'm looking to you. I lift my eyes unto the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Maker of the Lord. So as we worship, just come up, and ministry team, if you can just pray them to be filled with the Spirit and for faith to arise. And this morning, I'm going to pray for you, for your faith to arise, that you would go after the things that God has placed on your heart, whatever the situation might look like. Remember, I could have said, you know, when God said, I want you to stay in West Wales, I could have said, but there's no money, God. You know, what am I going to do? But actually, I put my faith in the word of the Lord and went back and looked, 6 months. That's a miracle. 110,000. We even got money from the Church of Scotland. I mean, that's a miracle in itself. Let's stand. I'm going to pray for faith to rise. And if you just need to make a declaration this morning, I'm putting my faith in you, please just go up to the ministry team. They're just going to pray for more, for faith. And let's just pray. Father God, I pray for the gift of faith to be released in us, Lord. We read that story, Lord, and we realize the importance of prayer and fasting and putting our faith in you, Jesus, not in ourselves, not in the situation, not in anything else, but in you, Jesus, so that you can do what you want to do in us and through us as your disciples. So let faith arise this morning and let the enemy be scattered. Let the kingdom come and let many in our families and in our communities come to know Jesus. And so we're just going to sing that song again. I declare Jesus. I sing Jesus over here. That's all right. Is that okay, Fee? Yeah, yeah. Oh, I speak Jesus. Yeah. Sorry, that's the right one. And let's, again, we've done this before. Let's speak Jesus over our situations. And we haven't got long to do this, so let's do this. But let's just go for it this morning. Amen.
Soul held captive by depression.
It's 12 o'clock. We want to honor not 18. So if you need to go and get your kids, please do that now. We're going to keep going a wee bit longer. But if you need to go and get your kids, please do go and get them and then come back. We'll pray. If you need prayer, we'll pray for you then. I just got this image. There's this beautiful image in one of the, I think it is in the Voyage of the Dawn Treader, the film that Disney made. And Lucy is really doubting that she is loved, and she's comparing herself to her older sister and, you know, her beauty. And there's a moment where just Aslan roars and it just blows apart what she's thinking. And she actually, and I just want to pray that Aslan would roar over you, that Jesus would roar as the Lion of Judah. And he, you know, for those of you who are really struggling with believing that you are beautiful, that you are worthy, that you are unique, that you are fearfully and wonderfully made, that you are beloved of God, I pray that Jesus would roar over you today, that you would feel something of the Lion of Judah and him saying, you are mine. You are mine. Remember, we said the banner of the Lord, we sang that, is over us. I pray that you'll sense something of the banner of the Lord, the banner of love over you, the mighty warrior banner, which has put a stake in the ground and said, you are mine. I pray that in Jesus' name, in the supernatural, we just pray for a release in that, and that we would have just faith in you and just courage in you to do what you've called us to do as your beloved sons and daughters. And now I just pray God's blessing upon you, the blessing of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit may remain with you and stay with you. In Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen. Amen. Have a great afternoon. Remember, tea and coffee, please do stay. If you still need prayer, just get there. Are people still praying, so please do that. And evening service tonight, bless you.